What's up, everybody? Episode number 77 of the After Show, but later. We have a lot for you this week. I actually have two pages of notes, so who knows how long this shit's going to be. Your boy D, Al Kukui, we got a lot for you planned today, so should we have Baseline Trey go ahead and help us get this shit started, Al Kukui?
Hell yeah, come on, Baseline Trey.
Let's go, brother. On the road to the riches, because it's all about the paper. Now buckle up your seats and prepare for the journey. Let the music ease your soul, grab a spliff and start burning. Relax with us and take a trip to the heavens and come and spend a day in the 757. What's up, everybody? Welcome to the After Show, but later. Al Kukui, do you have anything that you want to get started with this week, or do you want me to start naming off some things that we have, or what's going on?
I've got one thing for sure, and I'm pretty sure it's on your list too, and I'm just gonna say the neighbor.
Oh yeah, that bitch ass neighbor. If you guys didn't catch it this week, Covino actually had another incident with that bitch ass Mrs. Grundy from downstairs. So you want to go ahead and give a little recap and your thoughts on it?
I'm just gonna imagine her in a muumuu with catfish whiskers.
You know what though? One of the things that I was actually super stoked about is that I don't know if it was like the HOA or somebody that actually reached out and told him to delete her or block her off of his phone, and they were like, "We're gonna deal with her. Like, just fucking, you know, don't worry about it," because you know, it was really irritating Covino and Jordan and everybody involved, because this bitch is just a bitch. You know, she's just fucking like an old, sounds like irritable fucking bag of shit, you know? And yeah. I'm glad that they told him, hey, you know what? Fucking block her and don't even worry about it. Let us know if you're going to have any major projects or whatever, and then we'll let the appropriate people know. I thought that was awesome.
Me too. You know what I didn't like, though, is the ignorant-ass people that were chiming in saying that Covino thinks he's better and this and that. And, I mean, you know what? At the end of the day...
That was Andrew Hart. Because I was going a little back
and forth. Any relation to Kevin?
No, you know what, though? It's spelled the same way. And it's funny because I was going a little back and forth with him talking about, like, Bret Hart and Owen Hart. And we were talking about wrestling and stuff in the chat. And then shortly after we stopped talking was when Covino told that story. And then he was like, oh, Covino thinks because he owns it he's better than this lady and shit. And I was like, no, motherfucker, not because he don't think he's better. Don't you think he just has, like, more rights and shit because he does own the fucking place, you know?
Well, not only that, I mean, tell that dude to go look in the dictionary and read the definition of both of those meanings up, and it'll pretty much in the dictionary say that one has more privileges than the other. So I don't know if better is the right way to say it, but at the end of the day, he definitely, like they said, she doesn't even have the right to communicate with the HOA because she doesn't pay the fees. The person who owns the condo does. And so I don't know, man. You could just tell that lady had to be a miserable, unhappy old fucking catfish, because why would you be drawing all that drama up for no reason, especially if you're just fucking renting the place? If it bothers you as a renter, when I was a renter, if something like that really, really, really irritated me or I had a neighbor like that, you move.
Yeah. Yeah, that's one of the joys of fucking renting, right? Is that you're not tied down. If you buy, I mean, think about it. I was going to bring up an example, but I don't have to. I could use Covino. He's a perfect example because he fucking bought this place. So Rich had even said, Rich was like, if Covino wants to get out of this shit, he's got to fucking sell this shit. He's got to make sure everything's up to par. He's got to go through a fucking real estate agent. He's got to do all this shit. If this bitch is having that big of a fucking deal with Covino and Jordan, which it sounds like they're being pretty good tenants and this bitch is just a fucking asshole, well, she could just fucking move, you know? And if it's that big of a deal, why doesn't she fucking request another fucking unit whenever there's one available or some shit, you know what I'm saying? If she doesn't want to leave the complex or whatever.
I don't know, man. I do know this. Most of my adult life, you know, I had a couple houses, but for the most part, you know, since I moved out of my my parents' house, I've been a renter, and I've never had to sign a lease over 1 year. So, you know, sometimes that happens. You move into a spot where, you know, maybe they're complaining all the time, or maybe they're fucking watching you all the time, like that kind of shit, or maybe they just don't give a fuck and they're super loud and all kind of different scenarios. But at the end of the day, You weigh as the renter, you're like, is it worth it or not? You don't call and complain on other renters or people who own. Why would you do that? Just, If you don't like it, then leave.
I've never owned a place, but I've rented fucking the last however many years that I've been fucking on my own. And it's just the same thing. I've never signed anything over a year as far as like a lease or anything. So yeah, right. if you get into it and you're a couple months in and you're fucked, okay, well you're fucked for the next 11 months, you know? But right. Or 10 months or whatever the case is. And you know, so I just don't see why. And you know what? That the fucking bitch, the thing that bothered me is that she had like some whack ass like excuses as far as like oh, one of my roommates has fucking cancer when she's over here like smoking 24/7 and shit, you know? And I was like, yeah, what the, sure. Like, you know what? Honestly, I'm like, making up cancer is some of the most fucked up shit you could do, but I wouldn't put it past this bitch because she sounds like she's just somebody who wants to fucking like win the argument. So she'll, to me, it sounds like she's somebody who would go as far as making up shit. I can like almost guarantee you her fucking roommate doesn't have cancer, you know? And then like Covino and Spot, and I think Rich, I think all three of them said it at a different, you know, spot. They were like, if your roommate has cancer, you're fucking smoking. What the fuck is wrong with you then, you know?
Yeah, no, and not only that, it's just, again, I think Covino's going to win this one because the HOA, I mean, at the end of the day, they have an obligation to take care of the people who own property. That's what you pay your HOA for. And to what does that say about the HOA if you're letting one of your homeowners who pays your monthly dues and you know, the property looks good outside, the property looks good inside, they take care of their property, and you're letting them get bullied by a renter? You can't do that. You can't. And not only, and not even bullying, like the word, the verbiage that she was using, into, if you can't say midget, you sure as hell can't send text messages, which are evidence. Right, you voluntarily sent that. It ain't even like someone gotta have proof. You sent that, and you sent it to multiple people like a dumbass.
Yeah,
and you, that's a form of bullying, and so they're gonna have to take care of him, or they're gonna, you know, potentially face backlash and maybe a lawsuit. He might be able to sue them if they don't have his back. And to Andrew Hart, I just thought of a comparison. The comparison is, just because you walk the dog doesn't mean that you own it. Right? Lots of people walk people's dog, and that does not make them the owner. Just because you rent someone's place, you're not the owner. You don't have the same rights as someone who does. You're not the dog's owner, bro.
That's the dopest analogy ever. It's like a dog walker wanting to fucking, you know, go and get the fucking dog vaccinated and shit, you know? You're like, hold up. You're walking the dog, motherfucker. You don't own this dog. You can't fucking take him to give him his shots, you know?
No, you're not giving approval for surgery.
Exactly.
You know, and the thing is too, you know, to end that note, as an owner, you got to fix stuff that renters don't. You are way more responsible for stuff that renters are not. And at the end of the day, yes, you have a bigger say. So it is what it is, because whenever your responsibilities increase, so does your leverage. Should he sell and take the money and move on and try to buy, you know, like maybe a small house?
I don't think so. No, I don't think so. You know, and that's one of the things that is, if he does, then fucking what? This old piece of shit fucking wins. Fuck her, you know?
No, yes and no. I mean, she would win the battle, but if he made a lot of money out of it, like Rich did in this Texas house, he'd win the war, because she's not making nothing and she's still broke and she's still going to be bitching at the next tenant. Yeah. Whoever moves in next, she's going to pull the same shit until they kick her out. I don't know. I mean, I'm not saying he should or he shouldn't, but
you know what? I wonder if, and I think somebody brought this point up before, but I wonder if that's why so there was such like a turnover as far as like there was people that were almost buying it. Do you remember when Covino was going to buy it? There was people that were almost going to buy it and it kept falling through, or they kept like changing their mind or whatever. I wonder if these people had like short interactions with her. Yeah. Or you know, saw her.
Just saw the catfish whiskers.
Saw the fucking whiskers with the muumuu, and they're like, nah, this bitch sounds like bad news. Fuck this place, you know?
Hey, I heard her gang name was Gato Pescado.
Really?
Catfish, bro. That's what she tagged, was catfish.
Oh, that's funny. Oh, you know what? Speaking of nicknames and shit, fucking Husky Nipple Dog. I saw him fucking. I saw him commenting and shit on our stuff and giving us, you know, kind words and shit. So that was pretty dope.
You know what's funny, bro? It's his. He told me the story of his nipple actually used to be named Gunther. He had a name for it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, bro. And that's why, the husky nipple. Though? That's he had one nipple bigger than the other, and he said.
There's actually some a story behind that. It wasn't just like giving himself a random nickname for like Twitter or something.
Oh yeah, he flicks it like he dusts his shirt off and shit. Oh, he's wild, bro. Husky nipple. Shout out husky.
Well, I saw that shit that you sent me with him holding that like husky. What was it, like a an adjustable wrench crescent or something? Wrench. A crescent wrench. Yeah. So he had that crescent wrench with the nipple. And it said husky on it. You know what though? But I think that's enough for that fucking for that old Miss Grundy. You know what else I had on the notes that I think was very interesting this week that they didn't really go into as much as I thought they were going to, but what do you think about the smut tales from that Sarah's reading?
I think in about 5 years Rich is in trouble.
Why is that?
Because obviously, I mean, oh man, I don't know, man. I mean, I just don't think there's a lot of good that eventually in the long run comes off of something like that. Like, I don't know. Is it unfulfillment? I mean, what's the deal? What's the need to consume that much of that type of material? And from a man or a woman's perspective, either way. And I'm not against it. I'm not against it, but just the little parts they played for us, he's not fulfilling that role.
Joe Rogan had on this lady and they were talking about like testosterone in the fucking...
Hey, is that when you're still in Meckleville?
Yeah, when you're still in Meckleville, they were saying how the testosterone and shit like really like not only changes you like physically, like that turns you into like a boy, but will also change like your fucking brain and shit. It'll actually adjust the physiology of your brain. And it's crazy because it trips me out how that sounds like it's predominantly a female thing, you know, reading those smut tales, and dudes just want to watch like a fucking, you know, 30-minute porn, and they fucking flip through to find the good parts and they're good. And it's just like, I couldn't imagine like ever being fucking, you know, turned on or something by fucking reading a book. You know, that's fucking weird to me.
No, me too. But you know what it is? It's just different needs that need to be met. So what Rich needs to do is pay attention, and he needs to try to, like, obviously he's not going to fulfill the fantasy, but like some of the little details that obviously are important and why the books are being read, he needs to try to just tune in a little more, bro. I mean, I don't know what I think.
I think would be a fucking dope ass thing for Rich to do would be to fucking find the books that Sarah's reading and then order them on Amazon, like even or like a Kindle or some shit, fucking read them and then see what it is that fucking that she digs about these books. Is it like, oh, the dude fucking walks into the room butt naked with nothing but a beret, and then Rich could like randomly walk in one day with just a beret, and she'd be like, oh my God, how did he know? How did he know that that's what fucking turns me on, you know? I just feel like that's an exaggeration, but I feel like really, he really could be like, you know, and I feel like Sarah and Rich have a good relationship where they can discuss things, but I think little things that Sarah may not even think to say, like say they are discussing it and she's like, oh yeah, I liked this in the book, this in the book, this in the book. Rich might read something and catch something that maybe wasn't discussed. That, okay, cool, this might be cool, or this might be, I don't know, hot for me to do or for Sarah to enjoy or some shit, you know? I just feel like it could be an advantage if your chick is reading those type of books to fucking, to read them yourself, you know?
For sure, and you know, he already is self-admittedly, you know, the king of playing wiener games. So, yeah. I mean, why not? He likes to put it in a book. He likes to slap it with his, you know, the book with his thing.
And slap it on the remote.
Yeah, bro. Brush up. I mean, why not? He might as well at least read one, or maybe find one that she wants to look at or she's interested in. And even if he didn't even read the whole thing, maybe there was a new release or something that she was into. And one night he got a jump start and read like 5 chapters and kind of, you know, said, let's do it together or something. I don't know, but he better start participating in the smut tales.
I think Rich said that they were listening to them, right? Or Sarah was listening to them on the drive from Texas to LA or something. So she was actually even listening to the audiobook. So not only is she reading them, she's like listening to them. And fucking, it's crazy to think that like she's driving back from Texas and like just zoning out. Cause I know, Doug, whenever I'm taking a road trip, I'll throw on a podcast. the only thing I ever throw on is the Covino and Rich podcast, only on Patreon. And when you throw it on and you're fucking driving,
followed by our show,
you know, of the two shows that I listen to the best live podcast, which is exclusively on Patreon. And then I listen to the best recorded podcast, which is the After Show But Later. So, you know, you're listening to those two things as you're on your fucking drive, and you zone out. It makes the drive go a lot more quickly, but it's just funny to think that Sarah's thinking, like, you know, she's driving and you hear, like, and then he stroked her with his cock, you know, or something.
Getting all moist. Like, getting all moist.
That's crazy. Like, I don't know. That's just...
You know, you know what he should do? He should get one of those novels, bro, and he should get his iPhone, and he should read it, but voice record it and send her the fucking recording and try to do it in his... And you know, you heard him talking about Throbbert? He should get in his Throbbert voice and fucking record it all fucking... He's got to get rid of his Mickey Mouse high pitch. He's going to have to get rid of that, and he's going to have to go into his Barry White.
That would be so funny to hear him actually drop his voice like an octave and be like, you know, trying to drop it, but he can't because his voice is so high.
I'm Barry White.
And then he dropped, you know, his cock on her shoulder.
The velvet hammer as he came in nude in the buff.
You know what, though? I don't think that the Smut Tales is really that crazy as far as, like, it being, like, an issue or something in the future. But I did see people saying that, hey, Rich, watch out because their ex-wife started this way. You know, they started reading this shit, and the next thing you know, they were dipping, or they were not feeling fulfilled, or they were something. So I don't know. Maybe there's some truth to that. To me, it's just kind of like, I just feel like it's chick porn. Like, I don't feel like porn's really a big deal. Like, okay, you watch it, you get your nut off, and you move on with your life. And then I kind of feel like that's the same for females when they're reading these books.
You know what, though, bro? The problem is what you just said. That's where I think the problems start, because even what you said with dudes and their connection with porn, that's why women don't really like it, because they want to feel connected like Sarah is in the book. So Sarah's looking for something that Rich probably is never going to give. And then when he's looking for, when he's watching porn, is something that she probably doesn't want, because she wants that connection. And that's why I think those two things can be an issue, because you don't stay connected, because both are looking for something the other one doesn't want to give.
What did you think about the end of Wednesday or Thursday? I don't remember what day it was, where Spot... I had missed the first part of this, and I haven't gone back and listened, but Spot kept calling Rich, like, phone boy or something.
Yes.
And then they started getting into... When I actually was able to go back, like, when I was able to jump back into the conversation and listen, they were already starting to argue. So I kind of missed what happened. Was it Rich? Did Rich need to take a phone call during the show or something? Or what happened?
Did you hear a few months back where they were talking about it, where Rich felt he needed to call doctors and all kind of... Like, he had to make his calls in person, and Spot was saying he could do all that stuff online.
Remember that? I do, yeah.
Well, it came up again. So I guess Rich and Sarah stayed at Spot's house for a couple of days while they're waiting for the house to be dust-free or whatever he was talking about. So, you know, Spot again got on Rich for how often him and Sarah are on the phone. And I agree with both of them to an extent, but Spot need to mind his business, because just because you communicate, even like yesterday, bro, I'll give you an example too. Remember when Spot also was pissed off at Covino because he didn't use his phone to find something in Safeway or Vons or Ralph's or wherever
he was at?
Dude, I get it. Spot's right in those situations, because I was with my girl yesterday in the Home Depot, and we were looking for, I don't know, a fucking mini blind accessory, and we used it, and the thing worked great. But some people ain't like that. So Spot kind of gets on his high horse where he thinks... He went from quiet ass Spot, scared to talk to chicks, to now if you don't do shit his way, you're an asshole. And so he thinks Rich was talking on the phone too much, and he doesn't understand why Rich can't sign his documents via e-sign and do a, you know, because Rich's fallback was, as I was doing real estate, we were making real estate transactions, and I needed to talk to these people. And so Spot was just giving him shit for the amount of time he's on the phone. But Rich is right. Like, when you're dealing with real estate transactions, you don't want to always communicate via text or email, because tone and pitch means a lot in a conversation when you're communicating. And when it's important, I like to make sure that in important situations with doctor appointments or you know, in a real estate transaction, or if you had to talk to an attorney, I think the clarity you get from verbal communication versus written communication is super important. And I'd want to be on the phone with those conversations as well.
No, you know what? One of the things that Rich said towards the end of the episode that I couldn't agree with him more on, I'm not calling Rich a moron. The thing that I couldn't agree with him more.
It's all right, bro. You can do it. We don't mind.
The thing was when he said that because Spot had jumped in with the, oh, I'm not going to know this because I don't own a house and I don't have kids. Go ahead, Rich, say it. And Rich came and said, yeah, Spot's going to say that and then I have like no argument or whatever, right? But what Rich said was like, well, then what the fuck am I supposed to say, right? Because those are the facts. Spot, he owns a couple of houses, but he inherited them, like Rich said, right? He's never gone out and bought a house and dealt with everything that way, and he doesn't have kids. So
I'm sure he dealt with a lot to get them, but what he needs to, because he inherited them, there's a legal process as well, but it's a different process. So it doesn't belittle the fact of what he went through because he had to still go through a process, but the process you go through when you inherit something is not the same as when you purchase. The documentation's different. What you're signing for is different. It's a different process, and that's what he, it doesn't belittle. Yes, you own two houses. You just obtained them in a different way, which means the process was not the same. Exactly. You can't speak on something. Same with kids. Like, Spot's a great dude, and I don't mean to shit on him here, but you don't know what it's like to raise a child until you have. You don't know what it's like until your son asks you about a boner until it happens, or your daughter starts her period, or she wants to go to her first dance, or, you know, what it's like when you're short on scrap and money. And, you know, you still got to pay for a dance or shoes or hair or picture day. No, Spot, until you emotionally go through those challenges as a parent, you can look from the outside looking in, but it is not the exact same until you've actually experienced the emotions that go along with raising your own child.
You know, Rich used to be the guy that would say, oh, because Covino would be like, bro, right. you don't know, bro. And you know, for years, because Covino had his kid for fucking, what, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, for like 7 years. Before you know, Emmy came along. And Rich did fucking throw in the towel one time and say, you know what, I understand now. Like, I know I used to give you shit, but I get it now, right? And like you said, Spot doesn't get it. And it's not like, oh, bro, like, okay, it doesn't make you special because fucking a million people, a billion people have kids, right? Fucking who cares? But the thing is, your perspective is not going to be that of somebody who has kids, right?
And that's okay. That's okay. But it's
yeah, it's not bad. Okay. It's not bad.
But it goes back to even the tenant and the owner, right? When you take your nephew or your niece for the weekend, it's like you're renting them. Right? You don't have all the responsibilities that come along with being a parent. You're not getting up. If you took them Saturday and Sunday, you're not driving them to school, or in today's world, making sure they're on Zoom at 7 a.m. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Yeah, you oversaw them and babysat them for a weekend. And being their friend is not the same as making difficult decisions when you have to be their parent, or when you hit that line where you are friends with your kids, but now you got to be a parent and they don't understand. Like, those emotions, bro, like, it's just, again, it's not to take nothing away, because we need good uncles and, you know, we need Spots out there that spend time with our kids, that care about our kids. But at the same time, that doesn't mean that it's not the same, dude, as being a parent. It's not.
The thing that bothers me is that he fucking will argue to the fucking death instead of saying, you know what, Rich, you're right. I don't get it. Then fuck, if you got to take a call and you say you have to, then cool. If I remember correctly, I think Covino stayed a little quiet during this. You know what? He did, because he was doing that. He had like a fucking a zip tie or something, and he started making a mustache. Like, it was kind of like, and I had commented on the in-show thread. I was like, it's like when your parents are arguing or something and you start going and doing like a dance, like just trying to fucking distract them so they'll fucking be like, what the fuck were we fighting about? And, you know, because they were arguing and Covino was like, you know, and so I'm wondering how Covino felt when it came to all that, you know, like,
yeah, for sure.
You know, I don't really remember.
He's probably in the middle, bro. I see him doing a little bit of both because I do both, right? If I don't need to call and I can just reply to something, if it's a, and I do that on text, bro. If it's a reply, I'd rather text, right? If it's a one or two reply, cool. But me personally, if I'm gonna sit there and twiddle my fingers fucking 1,000 times to communicate, call me. Let's just get this shit over with. Let's talk for 2 or 3 minutes, 5 minutes, get it out. We talked about it, it's done, that's that. You know what I'm saying? I just, I don't know, man.
Something that I wanted to talk about. Okay, so we had, do you have anything before I get into something different?
I got two quick things. I got two little quick ones. I mean, I got a shitload, I'm sure, like you, but I got two little things we can fire off real quick.
All right. Well, what's up?
Team Rogers shirts, bro. Dad Bro of the Year. I think they should be in production somewhere.
You know what? That's something I wanted to talk to them about because I could make one like this weekend and get it up on Amazon to fucking for people to buy. I feel like telling them, hey, I'll make this shirt and fucking give you guys like half of the profits or whatever. It won't be much, but I mean, whatever. It's something that can contribute to the show, you know?
You could have a Dad Bro silhouette, bro, with a DBOY, a Dad Bro of the Year, and fucking on the back it just say Team Roger, bro.
I think, yeah, no, it was cool because when they had mentioned Team Roger shirts.
94 hog off.
We're just going to have a big old paragraph on the shirt. Team Roger, Dad of the Year, Hog Off Champ 94, fucking Twisted Sister, fucking Rock On.
Hey, and another quickie, check this out. They talked about something that they had talked about before, and I have implemented it years ago, bro, where you cover an X with a cutout on the picture. If you got some really cool shit, like I had this one with an ex, bro, where we took like a helicopter ride and it was a dope ass time, but I didn't want to not put the picture up. So I remember Covino was sharing his story a long time ago, bro, because when I did that it was like 2012 or 13, and yeah. I had this picture and I forgot whose face I stuck over the other person's, but I did the cutout, did a little double-sided tape, and bam. Have you ever done it?
Oh, so you've done like a physical fucking Photoshop.
Yeah, no, you just cut it like Covino's dad. I think when Covino told the story back in the day, he would cut people's faces out of like a magazine, bro, like famous people. And then you would stick the famous person over the face you didn't want in the picture anymore.
That's fucking hilarious. I vaguely remember that conversation, but I don't remember it 100%. That's fucking funny, though.
Comedy too, because then if someone sees it, if they, you know, you have a guest over or someone sees it, they're like, hey, how'd you take a helicopter ride with Ryan Seacrest, or you put someone, you know, put someone stupid on there, and then it also becomes like a topic of conversation, you know, and you don't have to take your damn picture down.
I think Sarah did that to one of Rich's exes, right? She put like a smiley face on one of the pictures. Did you hear that?
Yeah, fuck, why not?
This week on Thursday, the show was at a different time because Covino had his Melody's graduation whatever the fuck they called it.
Commencement or whatever the fuck
it was. They didn't call it commencement. It was like a something different. But Covino had that shit. What did you think about that whole story as far as like how fucking his ex's dude showed up instead of her and all that good stuff?
I think that just from the stories that we've heard, the shit that Layla's pulled, you know, just being mean and nasty, I think it's going to backfire on Layla, because what's going to happen is one day Melody's going to be able to voice her opinion. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, I don't know if Layla's a good mom or not. It's not a judgment about that, because at this point, Covino probably doesn't even know, because he doesn't see her every day, right? So
yeah.
She could be the best mom in the whole world, but the fact that you try to constantly shit on the other parent who's an active parent who shares 50% custody, just being mean and nasty like that, you don't get to take that back. Okay.
You know what?
So all the nasty shit she's doing and she has done since they separated, you know, Melody, obviously as an artist, you know, she's smart. Obviously from the things that Covino chooses to share with the audience about his daughter, she's gifted, she's smart, she articulates well. And obviously, I'm sure it weighs heavy on her. And, you know, why does mommy keep fucking shitting on daddy? especially when daddy's not doing it back. And so what you're doing is, not only is it not in the best interest of the kid, and she's emotionally, you know, putting her kid in these situations to witness them, and she's probably confused on why, but she's gonna have to answer for this shit one day, because one day I'm sure Melody's gonna hit her up. Why were you such a fucking bitch to daddy for? He never did nothing to you. Yeah. He did everything he was supposed to do, and you shit on him every chance you got. Why?
Yeah. You know, one of the things that I think is like fucking, it's just beyond me, dog, is like how she could have her dude go instead of her. Like, that's how, like, dog,
this she's is making it personal, bro. It's not even about, yeah, at that point, it's Covino, not even about the kid.
Covino said that it's not about fucking me, it's not about my ex, it's about Melody, right? It's for fucking me as her parent to go, for her as her parent to go, for us to go and enjoy our kid and this, celebrate this moment, and for her to be like, I don't want to go sit next to Steve or whatever, you know, like, so I'm going to send my fucking dude. Like, and then you know what?
But even
like,
think about that though. What kind of adult does that? You've got a dude who has got to be 10 times more weird for him, because that's not his biological kid, and he's willing to be the grown up and do more for the kid than you are as the mom. What kind of horse shit is that? And then not only that, what kind of example are you setting for the kid should she be in that situation when she has a 12-year-old? Are you the example or the exception? Well, I guess, you know what? You're the exception. And the worst part about it is, whenever there's fights, these things are always going to surface, at least in the child's mind, because which parent is always there regardless of the situation?
You know what's funny is that I don't know if she did it to like, because she didn't want to see Covino, or she did it to spite him, like, I'll show him, I won't even show up, or whatever. But it's fucking funny how shit works, because, like, Covino's like, oh yeah, that's her dude, cool, I'm Melody's dad. And they fucking, like, they fucking sat there and enjoyed the shit. You know, I'll go out on a limb and say fucking Covino probably enjoyed it more than if fucking Layla was there. You know, not because
she
him
would have
and this dude
been bickering with the dude back and forth and fucking whispering and shit.
No. Say the dude fucking couldn't go because there was only that one ticket. So say it was Covino and Layla. Who knows if she would have been like, oh, you're taking my armrest, you know, or whatever the fuck, you know, like for Covino, it was like, all right, cool. What's up, dude? Like fucking, all right. You know, like he said, he was very cordial. He said, you know, shook his hand. Hey, bro, take it easy. You know, whatever. Left, you know. He was a fucking just being like a dude, where it actually, I don't know if she did it to fucking piss him off or whatever, but it fucking, it made it better for him. So fuck her, you know?
And that's when you're Covino, you're like, hey, next time, can you just send the dude again? Because we got along great. And, you know, I mean, it makes it more enjoyable if you don't show.
Yeah, no shit. And, you know what though? I feel like,
But you know what that also says too, is even in that situation, again, she's telling her story without telling her story, that obviously she's the mad, bitter, upset one, and Covino's not.
I mean, and she's the one that wanted out. Dude, and she's the one that wanted out. That's what I don't fucking get about situations like
this.
She's
never going to be happy. And she ain't going to be with this dude very long either. You watch, because the same thing, if she's going to do that shit and she's still bitter, she's still unhappy, he's probably going through the same shit. You know what I mean? We could tell Covino wasn't all the way happy and he was there for Melody there on the show. Just
you know what?
Some of the stories that he said.
You know what? And I don't want to spend too much time on this, because I know if Covino listens, he don't want to hear fucking this shit. But
no,
anyway,
no, for sure.
The one thing that I wanted to talk about that I was like a little irritated with, and I'll fucking I'll call him out, fucking Captain Carl Ian, you know, on one of the Covino and Rich pages, you know, Covino had, or Rich or somebody had mentioned something about Layla. Right. And which a lot of us have known. All right. So a lot of us have known this part of her new life. And but we're like, fucking who gives a fuck? That's not any of our shit. We're team fucking Roger. Right. So why the fuck would we give two fucks about this? Right. And so fucking Ian had put, hey, did you guys know, you know, this and this happened, or this and this about her? And then other people were jumping in and like, oh yeah, I heard that too.
What,
you
is
know
this
how
in the fucking CNR reporting live or what?
Yeah, and they were like, how come nobody ever addressed it, or you know, on the air or whatever? And Covino jumped in and was like, hey, because it's not my fucking business to share. Whatever goes on in her new life is her business, you know. And so why the fuck would I share it? There's no fucking reason. And then people started jumping in and, oh, well, remember this and this. And like, I was like, dog, Covino, Ian, like, are you fucking serious, man? Like, don't be the fucking Perez Hilton of fucking Covino and Rich. Nobody gives a fuck about the gossip about Covino's ex, right? If you want to fucking do that on your personal page, or you want to fucking start a little secret group or whatever, but don't fucking put it on the Covino and Rich page where to me, you just look like a gossiping woman, you know, or forgive me, a gossiping person, you know, where
give some people a platform, bro. You give some people a platform and they just don't know how to act.
I don't get it. Cause I'm like, why the fuck would like, when people were saying, oh, they never addressed it, why the fuck would he? Why the fuck would he? That's the last thing he wants to fucking talk about, you know, on the air. And I know Rich likes to bring it up. Well, Covino, you're fucking, we all know you're divorced. Rich likes to bring it up like every fucking show. But why the fuck would, you know, I even give Rich props for not bringing up certain shit that he could have. Because he fucking, as a friend, he's like, you just don't do that kind of shit. No, you know, bro. And some shit might have slipped out this week or whatever. But for people to jump in on the Carl pages and start fucking, and the main person running the Carl pages is gonna start the gossip and shit, where more people are like, well, then you know what, I just went to her Instagram and I saw this and this, and other people are like, oh, I saw this. And then I think it was Rafael Busil who was like, why are you still following her on Instagram, you know?
Yeah, and that's then, what I'm just gonna ask right now, like, why
you know, some dude fucking replied and put, because it's too much trouble to go in and follow her or whatever, right? And I was like,
what?
That one
tap of a screen.
Yeah, that one click, that one, you know, okay, maybe you don't want to go through all your people, find her, you know, delete her, whatever. When she posts something and you see it, oh, cool, there's her profile right there for me. They found it. You click on her profile, you click unfollow, you're good. Why the fuck do you need to be following that bitch, you know? And it's just, you know what, we gave this shit way too much time, and I apologize to Covino if he's annoyed by this, but fuck, man, it's just something that bothered me a lot this week. Was
Team Roger Dad Bro shirts coming soon?
Fuck, man.
Hey, and for you, for the fucking Vatos out there, we might have Team Rogelio.
Oh, you know what? Actually, tonight, well, by the time people are listening to this, it'll probably be happening right now. We have UFC 263, and I'm fucking stoked because we have
Nate Diaz,
and we have fucking Stylebender are both fucking fighting tonight. It's gonna be fucking dope. So if you guys are listening to this instead of watching the fight right now, then fucking more power to you, because I'm fucking stoked about the fights tonight, man. Are you gonna watch them, or what's going on with you?
Hell yeah, I got to. And sorry if I'm doing a little crunching. My girl brought me a plate of breakfast, and I couldn't turn the bacon down, bro. So I'm not trying to be Captain Crunch a lot, but his bacon's hella good.
No, you're good. Don't even trip.
But yeah, hell yeah, I'm watching that fight.
Doug, I've always been a fucking huge fan. I don't say always, but as long as I've been into the UFC, I've loved the Diaz brothers. And fucking Nate, I'm like a little nervous because I don't know if he's going to be able to pull it out. But I'm fucking stoked because I just love watching him fight, man. Just watching his fucking attitude. And I know my homie Johnny used to be annoyed as fuck as we would see Nate Diaz, because he'd walk out with his fucking
little smirk. Hey, bro. He's from fucking Stockton, bro. Stockton, yeah, California. That city's a lot like Fresno, bro. It's a couple hours up the road, and it is cutthroat. It is ruthless. They don't fuck around. So what he's showing you when he gets in the ring every day, that is straight up Stockton. Even if I think I'm going to lose, I don't give a fuck. We're going to get this shit on. Yeah. You've violated me one way or another. And even if I don't have a chance, I'm going to make a chance, and we're going to figure this shit out.
Well, one of the last fights that they had stopped, I don't remember who he fought, but they had stopped it because he was like bleeding too much and shit. And even after the fight, he was like, I fucking bleed. He's like, if you breathe too hard on me or whatever the fuck, because he's fucking, he's got a lot of scar tissue and shit. And so he's a fucking G. He's like 6 foot. What does he fight at? Like 180 or some shit, or not even like it's less than that, right? Like 175.
175, I think.
170 something. But he's a tall fucking like 6 foot skinny ass dude that will fuck you up. And I just love that he's like doesn't give no fucks. He's a fucking like, I don't know, man. I just love watching, especially like the UFC vlogs and stuff that are up to the fight. Man, I can't get enough.
You know you're getting a fight. You know tonight, if you actually are paying for it, if you do pay for it, you're going to get your money's worth. Because
yeah.
The only way he's getting knocked out is if you knock him out. Like, yeah. He will get up. If he's got any kind of, you know, energy in him, if he can do it, if he can physically get up and fight, he's gonna get up and fight. And you know that unless he gets knocked out or he knocks them out, you're going to watch a war.
One of my favorite Nate Diaz finishes is where he has the dude in like a fucking, I don't even know what the fuck you call it, but he had him in some kind of submission hold, right? And he's fucking flipping him off as he's fucking still he has the legs like around the dude's neck or whatever, and the fucking, and you're looking at him, he's fucking looking at the dude, flipping him off, and he's like this, he's like, fuck yeah, and he's flipping him off, and then the dude taps. I'm like, that is the most gangster shit of all time, to be like, I'm gonna fucking flip this dude off as I have him in a submission hold, and he's gonna fucking submit. That, like, he's just a fucking gangster, man. I'm just,
That was always my mentality, too. I think his mentality also kicks him up an extra notch, because the thing is, you know, psychologically going in, he's not gonna quit. Like, so in the times when the fight could swing either way, or he hits you with a good one and the momentum swings his way, you just know he's not gonna quit. And the fact that you know he's not gonna tap out, it has to psychologically mess with the other fighter, you know what I'm saying? Because you're gonna have to knock him out, or you're gonna just have to go all five.
Yeah, I'm just excited, man. And then fucking Stylebender is back at the middleweight. Did he go up to like light heavyweight or some shit the last fight?
I'm not sure, to be honest.
I think it was he went up a weight class this last fight, lost, which is I think his only defeat. So he's this fight going back to middleweight and gonna defend his championship. And I'm fucking stoked because Stylebender is another fucking skinny ass tall motherfucker that'll fuck you up. And that's what I like about these dudes is that they're fucking hella unassuming. Like, if you saw Israel fucking walking down the street, you'd be like, I'll fuck that dude up. You know, he's like 6 foot four, but he's skinny as fuck. Not knowing he'll fuck you up, you know? It's crazy, man. I just love that shit.
He'll wrap your ass up like a snake and fucking choke you.
Yeah, seriously, man. I'm just excited about the fight tonight. And there was...
What about Mauser? Did you hear that Mauser conversation?
I missed it. I caught the ass end of it.
I don't want to misspeak, and I know sometimes, you know, I don't want to misquote. We've been accused of that before, so I'm trying to do the best I can.
I was thinking about that, dog. I was thinking about that the other day. I was fucking doing the dishes, and for some reason that popped into my head, and I was like, I don't.
To the after show, but later, you never want to disappoint nobody.
We don't. But what's up?
But they said something about Mauser. I think Spot fucking called him out for his communication with Mauser. And again, I don't want to misspeak, but I don't know, man. I don't think Mauser should be texting him when he's at work. Like, I don't. Mauser can do whatever he wants. And his and Richard's relationship, it is what it is. But quit fucking jumping the line, bro.
You know what, though? But it's not even fucking Mauser. It's fucking Rich that's feeding into it. You know what I'm saying? Because
he wants the attention.
He could definitely ignore it, but he's the one. And you know, what's funny is this is the fucking third time that Spot has addressed it, and it hasn't seemed to stop. Or, you know, of course Mauser's not gonna stop, but you would think Rich would be like a little like, fuck, you know what, you would think it would finally click for Rich, but it hasn't, you know.
Well, not only that, bro, stay off your phone and get tuned into the show. Is it, when you're fucking having those moments where Rich Davis is there, but he's not there, is it because you're reading your phone? Like, bro, you got a paid service now on Patreon where you guys reap all the benefits. Can we get your fucking full undivided attention? Chuck Taylor's, bro. Did you ever wear them?
Yeah. You know what? Actually, one of the times I met Covino, well, I met both of them. I don't know. This was maybe like the first or second time I went to the studio, and I had, dog, these fucking Chucks that were fucking, they were my favorite fucking shoes probably I've ever owned. They weren't your traditional like Chucks, you know, they were like this smoky gray that were fucking dope as fuck. You laced them up and then they had a zipper, right? So I would just throw them on with the zipper. Well, my sister had some that were fucking very similar, And I remember when we went to the show, we both had them. They were high tops, but they were dope. They almost looked like boots. And I remember Covino, he looks and he's like, me and my sister both had like very similar looking shoes. And he was like, you know what? He's like, I just love how fucking close you guys are. And he had like a little moment, you know? He was like, I just love it, you know, that you guys are so fucking close. He was like, you guys even have like the same shoes. He was like, I wish I had that connection like with my sisters and shit, you know? And so to answer your question, yeah, I've had traditional fucking high top Chucks, just the straight up black and white. I've had fucking low top Chucks. I've had plenty of Chucks in my life.
Never owned a pair, bro.
For real?
Never owned one pair.
You know what? It was probably never wore a
pair. I've tried them on in the store, but never wore them.
I dig Chucks, man. I had never worn a pair probably until like my sophomore or junior year of high school. And then after right. that, I fucking dug them. And I don't know, Doug. To me, they're just fucking like, they're comfortable. They're fucking cheap. They're fucking, you know, like everything about them I fucking dig, you know?
Yeah, I've always been a Nike cat, Jordans, Air Max. I mean, it's crazy because I'm still the same dude as I was back then. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, it was just always, you know, we would do the K-Swiss, the old school, the classic K-Swiss.
Yeah.
Sported those. But, you know, had like one or two pairs of Puma. But no, the Chuck Taylor, I mean, you know, I know people that wear Chuck Taylor. I know a lot of people that wear Chuck Taylors. I just never did it, man. I don't know.
You know what?
I always felt like I made my foot look like long and narrow, like fucking clown feet.
So yes. I wear a size 13, right? And I think in Chucks you go like a size above or a size below. There's something weird with their sizing, but yeah. But when I do wear Chucks though, fuck man, my shit stopped. Hold on.
All right.
When I do wear Chucks though, Doug, it makes me look like I have the longest fucking foot in the world. You know what I have been getting into? I actually just had a conversation with one of my homies about this. Cause I was like, I texted my homie and I was like, dude, I was like, I for some reason been like wanting to get into sneakers, you know? And I don't know if it's cause like, I mean, 24/7 I'm wearing like fucking like black. So I'm like, if I get like some dope ass, like clean, like fucking off-whites or something, I'm like, I think they'll look fucking dope just because I'm wearing all black. And then my sneakers are like, because like right now, Doug, like I have some fucking Adidas on. They're all fucking black. They're all blacked out. Even the little Adidas stripes are blacked out, you know? And so I was right. like, I think that'd be kind of dope. Just, so anyway, I was telling my homie and he was like, me too. I've been wanting to for a while. And it's funny because maybe about a month ago, I got this app. It's called J23. Watch where you at, right here. It's
oh, yeah, I've seen that one.
Have you seen that one?
Yeah.
Doug, I fucking bought this shit for like $3. It's a fucking dope-ass app. For anybody that is in the fucking shoes, you probably know about it. But if you don't and you're thinking about maybe getting in the shoes, this shit has every Jordan like ever released, because I would like Google Jordans and shit trying to see like the different releases. Like everybody knows the Jordan 1s, and then there's like
right.
the Jordan 3s. I think the 3s have like the little that little cement. Like is it that like little cement. Print that little print mm-hmm. that they have,
they're like the cement print, the leopard cement print.
yeah there you go. So
those are probably, I never had a chance to get those, bro. I think those are my favorites. I like the 4s too, and I like the 5s with the shoelace stoppers.
You know, I was looking, and you know, whenever I would do like research on Jordans, like quote unquote research, I'd have to go to all these websites and shit. Dog, this fucking app is fucking awesome. It has every release. So it has like, you know, Jordan 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like that. And then you click on it, it'll give you a little history about it. It'll say the Jordan 3s were released in 1992, blah, 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 blah. And then you can click on releases. You click on releases, it'll show you every version of that shoe that has been released. So say the Jordan 3s, there's like 30 fucking pairs of those, you know, different, different color schemes and shit, and you're like, holy fuck, it'll show you each one of them, when it was released, what year, all that shit. Dog, that app is something I've been like obsessing with, to where, you know, usually like before you go to bed, you fucking like, you're like, oh, I'll check Instagram or some shit, right? Dog, that is like the only thing that I've been fucking checking like in my spare time, because it's fucking dope. Like, I saw some dope ass Jordans that are probably like, I don't know if they go like almost to your calf, but they're like almost like boots. They look fucking, to me, they look fucking dope. And I showed them to my sister. She's like, those are fucking ugly. And I was like, shut up, bitch. You don't know fashion, you know?
before I go to bed, bro, I'm on TikTok with watching Old X Pro. All right, guys, Mike 2-5. The Rambo family. No,
Doug,
Michael
Tran. I got to show you this shit. So I have the after show TikTok. And then I have my personal TikTok. What's fucking hilarious is if you look at my personal TikTok, Doug, I don't know if they know I'm fucking Mexican or some shit, but every fucking thing, watch here. Look, I won't even look at it. Just look at my screen.
Well, they probably know your blood type.
Doug, look at it. Everything is about like construction and shit. Everything. That's fucking great. It's all fucking Mexicans. Look at half of these aren't even in English, Doug. I don't even know. Oh, shit, yeah.
Oh, there you go. Oh, my God.
Hey, oh, yeah.
You show too much, bro.
Oh, shit, man.
Who's that, Snacky Chan?
I don't know who the fuck that is, but she's bad. Look at. I was all looking nothing but construction and some bitches all dancing, huh? Fuck. Yeah, about that. We'll edit some of this shit out. No, but, oh, man.
I'm explaining the dude.
Yeah, fuck. Now I'm embarrassed. All right.
That's great.
Next topic.
Oh, fuck. What else you got?
Let me see. Oh, you know what? I had one that I wanted your opinion on, because I know you're a big fight fan, a big boxing fan, and I have my opinion, which I'll give after I ask you about yours, but Spot asked the question, because we had last week was the Mayweather Logan Paul fight, right? Spot, he asked us if we thought, or he was like, do you think what I wrote it down so I wouldn't misquote him, if Floyd is losing credibility for these fights?
I think slightly, yeah, absolutely. I mean,
I don't think fucking not I at think, all
I think I do, and I'm not saying that because I don't want him to fight anymore. I'm not saying that because I didn't find it to be a great night and a great experience, because I loved watching it. It was awesome. But there's a reason Michael Jordan isn't trying to play people for money right now. And Floyd should have as much, if not more money than Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan, as the greatest of all time, wants you to totally delete the Washington Wizards. He wants you to remember him crossing up Brian Russell and going into retirement. And at 50-0, I think that I'm not mad at Floyd, and I don't even need him to stop, but he's a version of what he once was. And if it's worth it to you to show the world that, because you're making millions, go ahead. But we're never going to see the same Floyd Mayweather that we saw before Conor McGregor. And if he's okay with that, and he's okay with showcasing that to the world, because I know that Logan Paul was a bigger dude. He's a younger cat. He's hungry. I know all of that. But Floyd did not dominate him even. Like, he won the fight. He won the fight. Don't get me wrong. There's no question whether he won the fight or not. But to let a fucking YouTuber come in who's only had 4 professional fights, I don't give a fuck if he trained with Ayo Adrian himself. The motherfucker's only been in the ring 4 times, bro.
I think it was only 3. It was 3 before that. It was, what, 1 loss, 1 draw, and then something else. I think I forget what the other one was. But he hasn't won one. Maybe it was 2 losses or some shit and 1 draw.
You wouldn't want someone challenging God and getting close. I'm just saying, bro. Like, I like the entertainment. Again, I'm not saying this from a perspective that I think it's horseshit. You blended boxing and entertainment, and I think that the Paul brothers really want it, so they're fighting. But, you know, you could want it your first day pushing carts at a grocery store, and that doesn't make you the store manager all of a sudden. So you're still going to have to get some experience and go through trials and tribulations. I think it made for great entertainment. I loved it. I would even have paid for it if I had to. Did I just say that? But with that being said, that is not the Floyd Mayweather that was Floyd made for. He did not make his reputation based off fights like that. And so I think, you know, if you want to remember him for what he was, if he keeps doing this shit, you're just going to have to go to like video. You're not going to be able to remember.
I think, okay, I'm going to take it back because I had written absolutely no. I think for people of our generation and, you know, older than us, I don't think so, because I don't know if they're really in tune with the fucking Logan and shit and all this, whatever. But I think for people of that generation, people that are a little younger than us, like maybe mid, you know, early to mid 20s, I would say those people are going to look at him like Mayweather, like a fucking joke, right? Like, because they're not going to know the boxing, unless they're like a diehard boxing fan, right? But for the most part, I think kids, just like any of my little cousins or whatever, right? They hear Floyd Mayweather, they're going to be like, oh yeah, that guy that fought Logan Paul. You know, right. So in that sense, I think in the future, his shit might be a little fucked up. But when it comes to like fight fans like Covino, I feel like there's nothing he can really do at this point because his career is over. So I feel
But that's only to the hardcore fans though, bro. There's a reason. So even like, let's compare it to the Last Dance documentary, right? These kids didn't really see Mike play either, and they didn't know that killer instinct, and they didn't know all the stuff we talked about. We put out I'm not Kukui ESPN, but they put out that documentary, and it kind of all clicks and makes sense that everything that everyone's been saying about Michael Jordan, after you watch that series, the documentary, it all makes sense. Okay, I get it. I understand, right? It clicks. He is totally painting a whole different picture for this generation. So I think that what he's doing is he's potentially sabotaging their respect for his legacy, because they're watching a very tamed down version of his old self. So as you continue to put that on TV, and this generation continue, that's how they're going to know him. And it's not going to make the same connection when you go back and watch old fights.
You know what? I heard George St. Pierre come out on Steve-O's podcast called Wild Ride the other day, and he said something really fucking really, really true. And you know, this is a little different because we're talking about people that are still fighting in their professional sport, as far as like UFC or boxing or something, versus Floyd, who's retired. But one of the things that George St. Pierre said was that a lot of these people, you know, like, he got out just in time before like a lot of the CTE and shit set in. You know, he was right. He dominated. He was dope. He said that there are some people that kind of overstay their welcome, right? So they may be the fucking dopest of all time, and then, you know, they start to get older, and maybe now they're 36 or 37, and they're not the fucking cat they were at 27, right? And so, right. Like, they're fucking fighting. Now they're not, you know, they're maybe in the prelims now or something. They're not the main event. They're not the headliner. And then, you know, little by little, they kind of dwindle out, and they fucking they stay a little longer than they should have. And it does kind of fuck with their legacy a little bit, because if they would have left when they were like, not even on top, but when they were like, you know, a little after their prime, maybe like early 30s or something, their legacy would have maybe been better than them kind of staying a little longer than they should have, you know. And right. And it's just like, I feel like that's a very good point. And I don't know if that's kind of in line with what Mayweather's doing, because he still can do it, but they're kind of like circus fights that he's fighting now, you know?
I think though, at this point, see, Eaton, if he was totally concerned with his legacy, I think it's the money. I think that there's a picture that we're not seeing, although he's made a shitload of money. We've also seen people like Mike Tyson burn all through that shitload of money. And I Michael Jordan isn't financially hurting. That's why you don't even see him in public. Imagine what he could command if he wanted to make a public appearance or speak for a company or do like a charity game that you're raising money. Like, imagine the money he could command if he was willing to do a one-on-one. If you got some YouTuber like Logan Paul, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Fighting Floyd Mayweather. But he doesn't do it because it'll compromise his integrity, or at least compromise of how he's viewed by the public. He can't live down the Jordan meme where he's crying, right?
Yeah.
The last thing he wants you to do is to get his old ass on a court where he's out of shape. Floyd didn't even train, bro. That was not the same cut Floyd Mayweather. And it wasn't for me just the fight. he just wasn't dedicated. That was not the Floyd Mayweather that got 50-0. He didn't come in chiseled. He didn't have no abs, bro. Like, he wasn't fat because he's a little dude, you know, and us bigger guys, I'm not going to sit here and call him fat because he was 20 pounds overweight, but he definitely did not train like it was the fight of his life. Mm-hmm. He didn't even, he looked like he rolled out of bed, bro, and showed up to the fucking arena and boxed that dude, took a paycheck and went home, bro. You know what I mean? Like, he'd been on layoff for 2 years, bro. And he's like, yeah, let me go get this money. And he did. And so, I don't know. Again, I'll watch his next one. So I'm not coming from a hater point of view.
You know, it's crazy, though, because you think about, like, how much money is enough. You know, you think, because, like you said, he could be burning through it at rates that we can't even begin to imagine. Like, you think of, like I heard T-Pain on a podcast recently where he said, like, in, like, 2010, 2011, this is, dog, like, 10 years ago now, right? Not even fucking not that long ago when you think about it. He had made all this fucking money with I'm in love with the stripper and fucking bartender and all of his fucking shit.
Right.
He had said he burned through so much of that shit that he was having to borrow money from, like, friends to buy his kids, like, Wendy's and shit and, like, McDonald's or whatever.
You know, but a basic way to kind of explain that where people will kind of get an understanding is, you know, you probably should have enough savings to live for, you know, a couple of years, should the worst case scenario happen and you lose your job. You should try to save at least enough to at least a year, bro, 6 months to a year where you know, you can still pay your bills, not miss payments while you're getting back on your feet. But that changes when your bills go from with rent to $2,000 or $3,000 a month to like 20 or 30 million. So if Floyd quits making money or his investments go downhill, he can go downhill quick. And I'll give you an example, bro. When I lived in Northern California, my house was $5,000 a month in a mortgage. You don't pay that for 6 months, bro. And everything goes up with it. Anyone who's owned a car knows the more valuable the car, the higher the insurance.
Yeah.
So the higher the taxes, right? Your fucking, when your registration came on my Mustang I just sold, dude, the registration was like $600. On my Corolla, it was like $210.
Yeah.
So everything goes up. Your fucking maid goes up, and you got the mansions he's got. What's he pay? $5,000 a month to keep that thing clean. You know what I mean? When he eats a certain type of meal. So the expenses are there. And so what people don't get is, yeah, he's made a shit ton of money, but he lives a crazy ass lifestyle that not most people live. And when the income stops coming in, whatever you got saved is going to go quick. It just is what it is.
It's fucking, it's crazy because it's crazy to think that somebody could go through the amount of money that they have. But like you said, the bigger the house gets, the bigger the maintenance, the bigger the expenses, the bigger. And it's crazy. Like, it's hard for somebody like me to imagine, like, going through that much fucking money, you know? And I don't know if it's because, like, I'm pretty simple as far as, like, Floyd likes to be flashy and shit, you know? And, you know, he's got, and I'm like, but fuck, would I be flashy if I had like a bajillion dollars? Maybe I would be, you know, who knows? But it's just, it's crazy to me sometimes.
You don't think, because I don't want all the, no, because you get the attention. The same motherfuckers that want to be flashy also bitch about the media and the paparazzi not giving them their space when they cause half of it just by the fucking crazy ass shit they do and they wear and they drive. You know what I mean?
Like, I think I would buy
sneaker.
I think I would buy more expensive black shirts.
There you go, bro. The ones that could be, you know, rich advertise.
Oh, you know what? Speaking of black shirts, I'm getting a shirt tomorrow, an after show but later shirt. It should be here tomorrow. If it works out fine, if everything looks good, I'll be fucking sending out the link this week so people can purchase after show shirts.
Can we get a custom one for a nipple pocket for a husky nipple?
A nipple pocket.
Yeah, he said it's so husky it needs support.
Oh my goodness. Well, we'll look into that. But yeah, but I'm excited because if shit looks good, you know, when I get mine, maybe by the time this video comes out, I will have it already in my hand. So if you guys are interested in fucking after show merch, we might have some soon. I'm thinking about fucking sending Spotty a tank top with a big old after show logo in the middle.
There you go. Or have Spotty with the super soaker and a bullseye of his neighbor.
Oh, yeah. Loogie, you know, man. What? Shout out to Spot for fucking acknowledging me this week. He had mentioned Loogie Boy or whatever. And
your Super Soaker.
And the Super Soaker that I had sent him. I wanted to talk about her real quick because, Doug, she's somebody who's like, if you're scrolling through like Pornhub or something, she's fucking beautiful. She's like really fucking pretty, right? But for some reason, dog, she's, I don't know, maybe she's not like skanky enough for me or something, because I don't, she's like fucking beautiful, but I just don't, it doesn't do it, dog. I'm just like, I'll just keep scrolling.
Softcore or what?
No, she's fucking, dog, she does some fucking crazy shit, but I don't know. It's just like, she's like a little too pretty. Like, I don't know how to explain it. Like, I was having a conversation with my homie Luis the other day, and I was telling Luis. I go, I think it was when I was in Tucson. I was like, it's a trip because, like, there's, like, I'm attracted to, like, all types of different women, right? Like, fucking, you know, curvy-ass Latinas and fucking tiny-ass, you know, petite bitches and fucking whatever, you know, whatever. But, like, I was telling him, it's crazy because, like, if, like, there's somebody, like, who I've always thought is, like, fucking hot for some reason is Avril Lavigne, right? Just a skinny-ass... Yeah? Dog, skinny ass plain white girl, right? Nothing fucking, nothing crazy about her at all. Like, nothing, right? But I think she's fucking hot for some reason. But at the same time, I wouldn't want to watch her in like a porno, because like, I'm like, to me, it's like, I don't know. She's not like fucking, like, she's not like all curvy and shit. Like, I don't know. To me, it's just like, I don't know.
It's not gonna, music video.
I'm like, it's not gonna, I'm like, it's not gonna do it for me in a fucking porno. But if I was gonna actually bang her, I would be fucking stoked, because I think she's bad as fuck. I'm just saying, like, it's crazy how, like, I don't know if that's like, if I'm fucking special when it comes to that, or if, like, cause to me, it's like, I feel like my when it comes to like smut and shit, it varies a lot. There's like shit I like in person and shit that I, you know, but there's shit in person that I won't necessarily dig, like, on the big screen. You know what I'm saying? It's just crazy to me.
Yeah, because... but what kind of screen you watch your smut on?
On a big screen, Doug.
Projector, bro. The whole wall.
I have this 8K projector.
Lana Rhodes.
Doug, I'm watching Lana Rhodes, like, with the fucking, like, a thing of popcorn. I'm like, oh, she's fucking beautiful. Like, you know, like... But I don't know, maybe she's
videos.
Just like, I don't know, dog. I just feel like she's not like, I don't know. I just like, I don't know. I don't know. That's a little TMI, but fucking, it was just weird. It's just weird to me, because I'm like, why is it that I'll find this bitch in person, like, fucking hot, but I'm like, like Avril Lavigne, like, that's a good example, because she's like a little skinny bitch, right? And I'm like, she's fucking, I think she's fucking hot, and I'd love to bang her in person. But not necessarily. She doesn't do it for me on the fucking big screen, you know? So that's what we'll call it whenever we're talking about smut. It's the big screen.
See, white chicks like her, to me, remind me of that fucking viral video on TikTok about the coochie meow meow. That fucker, worse than roast beef, bro. It's more like a mud flap. I don't know. I can't. It just, wow.
But yeah, no. Oh, you know what? One of the things that was funny, and I feel like this is a very particular person when it comes to, like, you know, when you have, like, a buddy over to your house, like, for the first time or something. If they're, you know, Covino and Rich, I don't remember which one was saying, but they were saying about, like, giving house tours. Like, you know, oh, this is my daughter's room. This is the bathroom. This is whatever. Doug, I've never been that person.
No, bro.
But it's funny because, like, again, back to my fucking homie. I'm sorry fucking if people are annoyed by Luis, but he is that person where you walk in and he's like, all right, bro. He's like, this is the fucking closet. And, you know, this is this and this is this. And he shows me, like, all the rooms and shit. And like, oh yeah, this is my fucking, you know, porch, and this is, and to me, it's cool, but it's not like something that I've ever wanted to be like, all right, well, now let me show you my bedroom and let me show you my bathroom. No. And like, to me, that's never been, but there's, it's like a certain person that's just you know?
Yeah, no, because I don't want to see your bedroom. And when, if I get visitors, I show you two things, where the restroom's at and where the beer's at.
Yeah,
that's it. You don't need to know nothing else, because I don't want you changing my channel. If you came over to watch something, it's already on, right? I don't need you fucking fidgeting with the TV. Here's the fucking beer. Here's the restroom. You want a chief? Let me know.
You know what? In Luis's defense, I would say most of, you know, like his you know, couple of places he's lived in Tucson is like, when I go to visit him for the first time in like a new place, I am going to be staying with him for like maybe 4 or 5 days or some shit, you know? So I could see,
you don't go in his bedroom, do you?
I could,
bro. What are you doing in my underwear drawer?
No, last time fucking he told me he fucking he was like, he told me, all right, he's like, come here, and he was showing me, you know, like what he was doing with his room and this and this, and you know, and so I'm like, all right, cool. I mean, that's fucking cool. I mean, I whatever, you know, that's just not
Like, he was showing like a remodel or something.
Yeah, like he was telling me about like how he was designing it and shit, and like how he was gonna do this and this, and he had like a fucking 70-inch screen in his room, and I was like, fuck, that's the big screen I was talking about earlier, you know.
For sure.
Oh,
shit.
But actually, you know what? We watched the Covino and Rich Behind the Velvet Rope in his room because he was showing me. He was like,
Spogo, right?
What happened?
You guys weren't watching Spogo, were you?
No. It was when Covino was in the fucking sauna of rage.
And oh, shit. I like that one.
Because he was showing me. He was like, oh, yeah, you know this. And check out this lamp and all this shit. He has like this dope-ass lamp. And then we got a notification saying, like, Covino's in the, you know, sauna of rage. So he was like, oh, let me throw this shit to my TV since we were right there. So we just – we were watching it, and I was kind of like – it was no big deal, but it's kind of funny when you're like, if somebody walked in, they would be like, what the fuck are these fruitcakes doing, you know? But and then you walk in, and we're both watching a dude on TV because Covino was in there arguing about I don't know what, you know?
Baseball.
I don't know, man. I don't really have a whole lot more. What do you have?
That's pretty much all I got, man. Just, you know, just the rich and the telephone. You know, again, I think in that situation, he's kind of right, especially with, you know, concerns dealing with the company or escrow or whatnot. That's all I really got, man. I don't got too much more.
You know what?
Like Taylor dude, Covino's neighbor. I don't wish any physical harm on her, but I'm going to talk to my Kukui cohorts and never mind. I better stop right there.
Hey, where did that Chuck Taylor thing come from?
Because I think Melody. Did you hear Melody? Like he took her.
Oh, she got her first pair of Chucks.
And she picked Chuck Taylors.
That's what it was.
She got yellow Chuck Taylors.
Hey, you know what?
I think for her, especially being an artist, I think for her that's a dope pick. I mean, for her that's awesome. I think that's the great.
You know what? I think
I just think I would look like Bobo the Clown with Chuck Taylors on my feet. I don't know.
I think Melody's next Chucks need to be some white high tops, and then she could fucking like paint them or whatever, do her art.
What about
on
British Knights, bro? Back in the day, did you ever wear British Knights?
Oh yeah, that was a big thing. Yeah, no, that was a big thing, dog. And you fucking
oh, you got your BKs or what?
Yeah, dog. We fucking that shit in the 90s, dog. We all had those fucking BKs unfucking tied with them kind of all fuck, dog. That was I never felt fucking cooler than when I got my first pair of fucking BKs and shit. I was like, fuck yeah, I'm like my brother or one of my cousins, you know, because they were all older and they all had them. So I was just like, fuck yeah, I just felt so fucking cool, you know?
I'm even going to date myself, bro, the kangaroos with a little pocket on the side.
Ooh, I don't remember those.
The Roos, bro, back those were early 80s. Those were D-boy shit. I think they were wearing those like on the East Coast.
You know
the
what?
Kangaroos.
My brother never really like grew out of that fucking BK phase and shit because like then after that, like in the late 90s, early 2000s was like where they had some that kind of looked like the BKs, but they were lugs. Doug,
yeah,
my brother fucking sported lugs. Every fucking pair of lugs that came out, my brother had them. The heaviest fucking shoes / boots of all fucking time.
And you didn't need leg day that week if you fucking wore lugs.
Fuck no.
Sure.
No, Doug, my brother, damn, I need to get him on the show one of these days because I feel like when it comes to like sports and shit, like he was all into like fucking do you remember jump soles?
No.
You would fucking Doug, there was these things you would put on your fucking
shoes. Oh yeah, you got 6 inches or something that you're supposed to be able to dunk. Yeah, bro.
Jump soles. Doug, my brother bought those and he would go running in them.
I got a story about those, bro.
Let me hear.
You can Google this dude, and we hated him, bro, but he his name was Ted Lilly, and he ended up being a Major League Baseball player, and the school, little elementary school I went to that we all hung out at was Miramani, and anyways, long story short, his dad or his mom, whatever, like, the parents split up, he went to live with the other parent, and then, like, one or two weekends a month, he would come visit the parent that lived in my neighborhood, and that fucking idiot would be out there in jump soles, bro. And I guess it worked, though, because he ended up getting drafted at some point, but he was always at the school playing basketball, playing baseball, and, like, none of us really knew him because he didn't go to school with us, but he would come on weekends, and he'd want to play, so we would play. But yeah, I remember he was always out there in jump soles.
Hey, you know what?
I think he ended up playing for the Yankees, bro.
Oh, really?
Yep. Covino's listening. Ted Lilly.
My brother is a little dude, right? I'm 6'2" and like some change. My brother is like 5'8.5" on a good day, you know?
Oh, he's shit.
And so, Doug, my brother.
In his jump soles? Is he 5'8.5" in his jump soles?
Doug, he would fucking. It was funny because him and my dad used to always argue about who was taller. Because they were both under like 5'9", but they both swore they were like 5'10" or whatever, you know? They'd be like, no, okay. Fuck you. I'm taller. And, dog, I was like, both you motherfuckers are fucking little, you know? Because I fucking, dog, I was as tall as them in like 6th or 7th grade, you know? And right. It's fucking funny because my brother at 5'8", he was getting rim like nothing, you know? And it's because he would go running and he was all into basketball. He would fucking do programs in his jump soles. He would do jump programs where it was like fucking calf raises and fucking squats and jumps and this and this. And motherfucker could get rim like nothing. And I was like, really? Holy fuck.
I've never been able to hit the rim, bro.
At 5'8", he was able to get rim like nothing. I don't know if he was ever able to dunk, but I know I would be playing basketball with him and I towered over him and he would just fucking boom and just get rim like nothing. And just or like when we would get the ball stuck on the side of the fucking rim,
he would just go
and fucking tap it out. And I'd be like, yeah, I was going to, but you fucking beat me to it, you know? Like, because my big ass couldn't get up more than like an inch off the ground. But yeah, man, those jump soles and shit, that shit just takes me back.
Yeah, that guy, Ted Lilly, he lived in Oakhurst, which was like, I don't know, like 20, 30 minutes from Yosemite, and he went to Fresno City, but he played for the Yankees, the A's, the Expos, the Dodgers, the Cubs, and the Blue Jays. And Ted Lilly, he was fucking Mr. Jump Sole. If I opened up the dictionary, bro, and there was a jump sole definition, I'd expect to see his big old fucking mug in there because he was Captain Jump Sole in my neighborhood. Only one in my neighborhood using them.
I don't think that was really Covino and Rich's shit because they were more like baseball and shit, and that was more of a basketball thing. But I wonder if they do remember him. I wonder if they even, you know.
Oh, Covino probably. He's a diehard Yankee. Covino at least knows his. If he was on the Yankees, Covino knows his name for sure.
I watched something on Apple Plus last night. It was like Apple TV Plus or whatever. And the only reason I watched it is because Apple TV gives you like a free year or some shit. And so I was like, I was on Apple TV and it was like, do you want to do your free year? I was like, oh, fuck it. So I clicked yeah.
And, Ted Lasso, bro. Watch Ted Lasso if you haven't.
Is it on Apple TV?
Oh, it's dope.
You know, I definitely want to check it out because I was thinking, though, when I clicked yes and it was like, oh, yeah, like $14 a month or whatever the fuck it said after that, after the trial period. Doug, I was thinking about like all the services I have when it comes to like TV and shit. And I was like, fuck, dog, it's crazy because like I know this is like an obvious observation, but we all cut like our fucking cable and shit because we were like, oh, why the fuck are we gonna have cable when we can save money and get Netflix, Doug? And now we have Netflix and Paramount and Hulu and Peacock and fucking Apple TV and Disney Plus and fucking Doug, there's so many fucking things now. The only difference is you're most likely not paying for them all at the same time, you know? So it's $15 here, $10 here. Yes. $4.99 there, $10 here. You, like, Doug, like the UFC Fight Pass. Okay, that's like another $10. Like another fucking... But I'm like, I fucking love it. It's got the whole library and archives of all the UFC shit. So I'm like another fucking $10. And then like you'll look at your fucking like credit card statement and you're like, what the fuck? You're like, oh yeah, this shit got taken out.
$140, bro. Cable was fucking $65.
Yeah, and now you're fucking... when you think about all the services you have, you're like, holy fuck, it's crazy because it's like just as expensive, if not more, than it was fucking for cable, you know?
Well, you know what the sad thing is most of them, unless it's a UFC Fight Pass or like a Showtime or a HBO Now, a lot of them show the same shit anyways, right? Like they all have their own, like little Netflix has their own like Netflix programming and like Ted Lasso is part of the Apple Plus, but each one of them only have like 10 or 20 shows their own and pretty much all the other shit is the same damn shit.
Well, think about it. Like when Friends.
I rotate, bro. I don't get them all at the same time. If HBO Now has something hot or there's a series cracking off or something, I'll you know, like if I want to watch Ballers or some of the new shit they got going on, boom, I'll tune into that. When it's Power Time on Stars, I'll cut that one off and I'll jump over to Stars. Mm-hmm. If Showtime got some shit going on, because you can binge watch. The cool thing is, a lot of times, especially if you're behind, You can binge watch. So I don't need this shit for more than a couple of months. So yeah. My main go-to is the Google TV.
Right now,
YouTube TV.
Oh, for real? You have YouTube TV?
And that's been my go-to. DirecTV, my signal went out, and they wanted to send a technician in the middle of COVID. And I was like, hell no, I don't want your fucking cooties. So at that point, yeah, either you can go outside and check that shit. You know, it was like March of 2020. And I was like, no, you can fucking break a leg.
Yeah.
You ain't coming in. You know what I mean? And so at that point, it was kind of like, well, to resolve the issue, they got to check all the points of, you know, the source, the income, the input, output, all of it. And I was like, fuck it. You know what? My internet is working just fine. And I'm not under contract no more with these bunk ass fucking satellite companies. So I just went with YouTube TV, bro. It's the same shit. And you know what? DVR.
I need to go through and check out like all the services I have and get rid of fucking certain ones, because there's shit that like I had HBO Max. I mean, I have it, but I'm like, I mean, I watched the Friends reunion and fucking, you know, I'll usually have on like Big Bang Theory in the background, but that's it, dog. Like, I'm not really watching anything. So I should probably cut that shit off.
It's $14.
Yeah. And I'm like, fuck, I'm trying to think of other shit where I'm like, Doug, fucking something charged me for an app the other day that I forgot to cancel the subscription, and it was like $6.
Lana Rhodes OnlyFans?
LanaRhodes.com.
I heard she's going to start joining the Los Lonely Fans here soon.
Yeah, I want to watch Lana Rhodes, but like a little trashier. Like, I want like mascara running down her face or fucking
smut version.
Maybe her hair not brushed out. You know, she's got like really nice hair and she's really pretty.
You gotta brush
like,
the teeth though.
You know,
teeth.
That's a big thing. But I want her hair to look a little nappy. You know, I want fucking. You know,
gotta put it. You gotta make it that way, bro.
That's true.
Up to you.
That is true. Do you have anything before we bounce?
No, I don't, man. Thanks to everyone who supports us.
I'm so excited, man. I know we're gonna have Crystal Bray pop up on this. She's got her sister to listen to us. So, shout out to her sister, the family, everybody. I know they've been Crystal and her family's been moving and shit. So good luck with all that to everybody else.
Big on the CNR and big on the CNR forums too, because I hear that name a lot. And so, yeah. Hey, shout out, great involvement. That's dope, man. I get excited when I hear it.
Of course, got to give the normal shout outs to like the Pete Huffmans who have been there, the Soupies, the fucking Jackson Optimist, my little homie, and fucking every. Oh, you know what? I have two shout outs specifically.
Baseline Trey.
I have two fucking shout outs I got to give out specifically. I won't forget Baseline Trey, but Doug, there's two people specifically that I got to say what's up
to. Nip.
One of them is my homie Noe. He's one of my good friends' brother-in-laws, so. I seen him the other day. You know, we went to, there was, oh fuck, I'll talk about that next episode. A gender reveal. I thought they were dumb as fuck until I actually went to one. It was cool. It was a good time. But
really?
Yeah, one of my best friends, his name's Chris, he had a gender reveal the other day and he had invited me and I was like, I don't go to that whack ass shit. I'm keeping it real, you know? But right. I've only seen this dude like twice in the last like couple of years, you know, and he's one of my best friends. So I was like, you know what, I'm gonna go and fucking, you know, whatever. It was fucking so nice to see him and the family and shit. Well, his brother-in-law, Noe, I gotta give out shout out to Noe. He told me, he's like, oh yeah, he's like, how's the podcast going? And I was like, podcast? He's like, how the fuck does Noe know I have a podcast? Like, he's not on my social media or nothing, or Facebook or nothing, you know? And then I was
shout out Noe.
I was like, oh, I go, it's going pretty good, man. I was started talking to him about it. And then he was bringing up specific episodes. And I go, oh, shit. It's not even like he's just fucking blowing smoke up my ass because he heard maybe Chris told him or Chris's sister or whatever. He was bringing up specific episodes. And he was like, yeah, when you guys are talking about this and this. And I was like, oh, fuck, he really listens. He's not just full of shit. So shout out to Noe. And then shout out to another homie. His nickname's Poppy. And
I'll never call him that. So if he can get me a different nickname, shout out. Thanks for your support. But man to man, I can't do it. So
you know what, though?
If he's from the hood, he has to have four or five different nicknames. So choose one of your other fucking four or five. Shoot it, and we'll shoot you out that way.
But yeah, it was crazy as fuck because he was somebody who I seen the other day. And he was like, I was on my way to work. And he was like, Daniel. And I looked. I was like, who the fuck like is honking at me? And I rolled my window down. he was like, hey, bro, I've been catching your podcast. And he's another fucking dude that I never in a million years would have thought would have listened to the podcast or anything, you know? So shout out to those
Thank
two
you
people
for
yeah, fucking Noe and my fucking my homie Jose. His name's Jose. So
right. Hey, I got one last deep thought for you.
What's up?
You talk about a gender review, bro. I mean, a gender reveal party.
Yeah.
Is the new cool thing? It come out purple and they're non-binary.
Ooh, not at the one I went to. These were some old school Mexicans, and that shit was This was straight up blue.
Did it come
blue.
Out with a flag, bro? Did it come out green, red, and white?
They did. They popped the thing, and it was a...
And beer came out. Oh, that's awesome. Hey, if I ever go to a gender reveal, that better happen, or I don't want to be there.
Oh, you know what? Speaking of fucking... let me see. Let me... Speaking of beaner shit, I got a fucking... My new fucking gem. This is my new fucking gem. That's an old ass fucking song. Came out in like 98.
I think my neighbor's barbecuing playing something similar right now, bro. You look like you're about to get into your mode right now.
Dang.
Bro, you got an audition for a novella. Damn, bro, you look like it went touch your soul.
Fuck it, Doug.
What was the question?
Doug,
what's the question?
He said, like basically, el frío de mi cuerpo pregunta por ti. Like, basically, like, my fucking, like, my body's aching for you, right? Like he fucking misses
that
her.
That sounds like one of Sarah's Smut novels.
Like, he's saying, like, Doug.
Bro,
like,
are you listening to Smut or what?
No, hey, you know what? The last time I heard this song was when I was in Tucson and fucking Luis was playing it. And I was like, dog, I had never heard it before. And I was like listening to it. And I was like, no, I was listening to it. I was like, dog, you could hear his fucking pain. You know, like when he says, like, no hay nada más difícil que vivir sin ti. Where there's nothing fucking harder in life than living without you. Like, you know, no hay nada más difícil. Nothing more difficult que vivir sin ti.
He like, never got the memo, bro? You're lucky if you get 10 good years nowadays.
Fuck, dog. Like, hearing this shit, like...
You get 10 years, you're good, bro. Better not put a tingle in my dingle,
like,
bro.
Like, fuck, dog. Like, you hear this shit, you could hear him suffering. Speaking of Crystal Bray, she's a Latina. And I had put a picture of one of the songs from, like, Los Bukis, I had put. And I've
seen that.
And she was like, oh, that shit's too Mexican for me. When you're like, hey, what was he asking? What was he asking? Tell me the question right there. What was he asking?
A little bit. I just heard a question right after I go there. I was like, what's he asking?
Yeah,
bro?
No, but I think, you know, it's funny as fuck, because what I'll do, because I only fucking understand like half the songs anyway, because my fucking Spanish is so terrible. But what I'll do is I'll fucking, like, if there's a song like that where I hear the fucking emotion and I could hear him fucking, like, you know, like, you know, what did he say, like, fucking, I don't can't even think of some of the shit he was saying, but when you hear it, you're like, fuck. Then I'll go back and I'll listen to it, like, with, like, ears to, like, translate and shit and actually understand what he's thinking about, you know? So I got
a homework assignment for our listeners, too.
What's up?
Leave a comment on one of our social media forums. How many of you live in a neighborhood where when you're driving by or just even at home, music is played? Similar music's played. Like, reach out to us. Let us know the vatos out there where you're in the neighborhood where – you don't have to put it on, or you can just open the door and someone's playing the music.
But anyway, I've been trying to wrap this shit up, and I keep going off on a tangent. So episode number 77, we appreciate all the love from everybody out there. Pete Huffman, that's one that we don't mention very often, but does give us a lot of love. Fucking Glenn Wiley is another homie. So just everybody, we appreciate it. The one and only Steve Covino, who supports the show. We fucking couldn't thank him enough. All the shout-outs he gives us. So we really appreciate
Big Steve.
Big Steve, Baby Steve, fucking I know that Covino lost a friend this week from the SiriusXM family that was also a Carl. So, you know, our condolences R.I.P. to them and the family and all that good stuff. And we'll Turbo see you. Man. Okay, episode number 77. Me and El Kukui, we're out. Baseline Trey, please take us out, homie.
Baseline Trey. Just because it's all about the paper. Now buckle up your seats and prepare for the journey. Let the music ease your soul. Grab a spliff and start burning. Relax with us and take a trip to the heavens. And come and spend a day in the 757. Yeah, no.